It's time for the news, so here you go. If you're joining us by way of TV Crib, Channel 10, we want to thank you for being there, Mr. Tata, and we hope that what we'll be talking about today, you would most definitely benefit from it. All right, without any further ado, I'm about to welcome to St.Maarten and also to our guests for today and our friends. I'm talking about Bishop Nathaniel and Bishop Kanai, both of whom are here to talk about, you know, where they are established, and of course, they are representing Israel United in Christ. And we'll hear a little bit more about it. For those of you who don't know, if you've heard them before, well, at least you would be showing some interest. All right, without any further ado, I'd like to say good afternoon to both Bishop Nathaniel.
Good afternoon.
And also to Bishop Kanai.
Good afternoon.
All right. So you guys are here in the Caribbean, obviously, to talk about preparing and wake up our people for the coming of the Black Messiah.
Yes.
I think that should speak volume for those listening, because right away they will know that you got to be black to talk about the Black Messiah. In any case, we got to get to the bottom of the whole thing. But tell us a little bit about where you are established, because obviously this is not a new movement, is it?
It's been around since the 60s. We are established throughout the United States of America, the United Kingdom, the Caribbean, and the West Coast of Africa.
Okay. We're in the Ghana. Caribbean. We're in the Caribbean.
Jamaica and Trinidad.
Jamaica and Trinidad.
Yes.
Do you have aspirations to at least maybe establish yourself here?
So oh, yes. Yes, definitely.
That's the reason why you're here?
Yes, sir. The scriptures say that the Lord will set up small sanctuaries among the countries wherein the children of Israel have been scattered. Mm. So our goal is to gather the children of Israel, and that's who we are.
Okay. Who we?
We. Those blacks and Latinos who were colonialized and enslaved from 1492 all the way up until the 1800s. Mm. We are the children of Israel.
Do you have anything to add to that, Bishop Kanai? When I talk about the we.
Well, first I want to say thank you for allowing us to come on this venue so we have the opportunity to spread this word to our people. And the we, I know it might seem controversial to some because established religions of the earth today has lied to our people. They have not told them the truth of the Bible. They have not told them that they're the Israelites. And I'm being general. All religions are lies. Mm. There's only one truth. And the one truth is that we must keep God's commandments, that we must believe in the Messiah as it is written, which the white image of him is a lie, and that we are the children of Israel. So our objective here in St.Maarten and throughout the world is to spread this gospel as we are commanded. We are the prophets sent back on the earth. So we, later on today, hopefully in this program, we open lines and we take all questions based on what we are teaching. But everything we teach will be based out of the Bible, not our perception or our feelings.
You both can respond to this, but the obvious question would be, where do white people fit in here? Are they part of this or what?
White people are the children of Esau. When you read about Jacob and Esau in Genesis 25, they are the seed of the wicked. That's who they are. And the Bible says, what I'm saying is not something I feel, it's what the Bible says. Mm. According to Genesis 25, Malachi chapter 1, verse 4, Romans 9:13, Hebrews 12:16.
Okay.
They've always been the children of the wicked. We can't change that.
But isn't God a God
of all people?
Forgiven and, of all people.
Okay.
And forgiven and will forgive even the wicked.
Oh, well, let's get that in Romans 9:13. I want to go to the New Testament first, because many times we read from the Old Testament and Christians have been brainwashed to think the Old Testament is forgotten. So they only go by the New Testament. I'm going to show you that what the New Testament says, same thing the Old Testament says.
This is the book of Romans, chapter 9, verse 13. As it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated.
So God says he hates Esau. Esau is the progenitor of the Caucasian race, which is the nation of Edom. Mm-hmm. Now, forgiveness. If we can go to Hebrews 12 quickly. Hebrews, because you ask, isn't God a forgiving God? He is a forgiving God. He's a forgiving God for his people. Okay, read that.
Hebrews chapter 12, verse 16. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright.
Right.
For ye know how that afterward when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected.
See that?
For he found no place of repentance.
There was no repentance for Esau. And this is the misconception in Christianity. They say, oh, everyone gets repentance. That is not true in the Bible. People throw these broad statements out, but when you finally read it, it says Esau gets no repentance. So Christianity is a lie. All these Christian churches you see throughout St.Maarten, Jamaica, the UK, America, they've all been established by the oppressor. Those who enslaved us established these churches, and we run head into them, including Seventh-day Adventists. I don't know if there's some of you listening right now. Ellen G. White, a white woman, set up the Seventh-day Adventist church. Okay, and they, oh, we keep the Sabbath, we keep the Sabbath. The Sabbath was a law for the children of Israel. It was a covenant for the Israelites, but we broke it. We broke every commandment God gave us. That's why we went into slavery. That's why we suffer so. Can I prove that? Give me that real quick. Give me Deuteronomy 20. I got to prove it. Because you're giving me this look, Wendell. You're going, I don't know about that.
Well, guess what? I'm here to make sure that you're even in balance here.
Okay, very good. Keep me in check. Watch this. Deuteronomy 28:15. This is when the Israelites made their exodus from Africa in Egypt. Go ahead.
The book of Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 15. But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments and the statute which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee.
I'm only going to read a few curses. And you tell me if it happened to the white people in Israel or if it happened to us. Verse 32.
Deuteronomy 28:32. And it says, thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and there shall be no might in thy hand.
So one curse, your sons and daughters would be taken from you, given to another people, you would have no might to reunite your people again. No might, meaning no economic might, no military might. That's one curse. Verse 48.
Verse 48. Therefore thou shalt serve thine enemies, which the Lord shall set against thee, in hunger and in thirst, and in nakedness, and in the wants of all things. And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he have destroyed thee.
So the next curse is you would have a yoke of iron upon your neck until you've been destroyed as a people.
Okay.
Last curse, verse 68. Now watch this.
And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships.
The word Egypt means captivity. And the Lord shall bring you into captivity again with ships. Go ahead.
By the way, whereof I spake unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you.
So the last curse is that you would go into slavery on ships and be sold unto your enemies. So let's examine. Let's recap real quick. Your sons and daughters would be taken from you. You would have yokes of iron on your neck, and you would go into slavery on ships and be sold to your enemies. Did that happen to the Caucasian man in Israel who says he's the Jew?
No.
No, no, not at all, Wendell. Not at all. This happened to us. This happened to you and me.
You're getting a little excited here.
Yes. I love that. Right. I got that passion.
Mm. All right. So then are you saying basically that white folks are evil?
What God is saying is the Lord has rejected them. Mm-hmm. They are not. Get Matthew 15:24. People like to reject the words of Christ, but he tells us what he's saying. I know you got a call coming in probably.
No.
Oh, I'm too loud. I'm too loud. I'm sorry. I got a big mouth. Matthew 15:24.
The book of Matthew, chapter 15, verse 24. But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
People hear that and go, no, that's wrong. Christ is delusional. He's for all mankind. That's what Christians have done. Okay. But if you are.
That's not true.
That's not true.
All right. So let's get to it.
Okay.
To the bottom of it. What color is Christ?
Jesus Christ is, he looks just like you and me. As dark as you. Watch, I'm gonna prove it. I'm going to prove it. Get that. Do you think people saw Jesus Christ?
I was of the opinion that it was kept a secret as to what he would look like.
Ah, a secret. Is it window
say? Isn't it true that the Bible says that the secret things are of God?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. Give me that, Revelation chapter 1. Well, first, I gotta read this. 1 Corinthians 15, watch this. And that he was, I'm in 1 Corinthians 15:4, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are falling asleep. So Christ was clearly seen. So we got to knock that lie that no, I see, all through St. Martin, nobody ever seen Jesus. Then how did they nail him to the cross? How was it possible? Was he invisible? Now, Revelation 1, please.
The book of Revelations, chapter 1, verse 14. His head and his hair were white as wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet were like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace.
So, he had white woolly hair. You know what wool hair is, right? Woolly hair. Yeah. Then it said in his feet like fine brass. Brass is brown. As if they burned in a furnace. Mm-hmm. That means not a light brown, a very dark brown. Mm-hmm. If you burn white rice in a furnace, what color will it get?
You tell me.
Black! It's going to get black if you burn white rice. You know how to cook.
All right. Hold for a second. Let me get our audience more involved in all this and let them know that I'm here with both Bishop Nathaniel and Bishop Kanai, both of whom are here representing Israel United in Christ. And of course, yeah. And they're here, of course, to talk about what's going on. And basically, they say to prepare and wake up our people for the coming of the Black Messiah. I was of the opinion, and answer me about this, that based on what I know of the Bible, and I would consider that the Caribbean, a large part of the Caribbean are very religious people. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that means anything or that might be a very soft tone to say religious people. But I believe that it is also established that God is a God of the whites and the blacks. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I can get my mind around the fact that the only people that would inherit God's mercy would be black people. It kind of doesn't speak, but maybe you have a difference of opinion. But how do you answer to that?
How I answer to that is biblical, of course. Remember Isaiah 55. Can we read that?
The book of Isaiah, chapter 55.
I believe it's verse 8. Yes. This is the first thing our people must acknowledge in these religions that they found themselves in today.
Isaiah 55 and 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. As the heaven is higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts.
This is why Christ instructed us, saying we must be born again. Everything you and I have been taught has been based upon television. Things that the oppressor has put out in the media, and we have been brainwashed and bewitched by it, never verifying what the white man has taught us in the Bible. Get Amos 3 and 1. Now, you said you can't wrap your mind around him just being for one group of people.
Yeah.
Let's see what the Bible says about it. Amos 3 and 1. Watch this very closely.
The book of Amos, chapter 3, verse 1. Hear this word that the Lord has spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family which I brought up out of the land of Egypt, saying, you only have I known of all the families of the earth. Therefore, I will punish you for all your iniquities.
See that? It says you. You know what you only means? Only you. So we have been miseducated when it comes to the word of God. This is why Christ said, I'm not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. We have been misguided and miseducated to think that Christ contradicted everything the Old Testament said. No, he didn't. He fulfilled what the Old Testament was saying. Okay. Christ said, I'm only for the Israelites. We just read in the Old Testament, God only knows the Israelites. Although he created all nations, he had a chosen nation. Like you may have a closet full of shoes. You have a favorite pair.
Yeah.
Okay? And it's the same thing with the Creator. Okay? Get Psalms 147, 19 and 20 to show you that we're not twisting scripture. That's why I let them just read it so you can hear it for yourself. Okay?
The book of Psalms 147, verse 19. He sheweth his word unto Jacob, his statutes and judgments unto Israel. He hath not dealt so with any nation. And as for his judgments, they have not known them. Praise ye the Lord.
There it goes again. So all through the Bible, I only know Israel. I only gave my laws and statutes to Israel. But these religions that have been set up by our colonial slave masters has contradicted everything in the Bible. Everything.
Let me ask you a question in regards to Israel. Mm. Because you are Israel United in Christ.
Yes.
Who are the Israelis?
I'll let the Bible answer. And you're going to find out, when your listeners hear this, you're going to find out whether they believe the Bible or not. Revelation 2, 9.
The book of Revelations, chapter 2, verse 9. I know thy works, and tribulations and poverty, but thou art rich. I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan.
You hear what Jesus said? Because during that time, you had Herod, Agrippa, you had many Roman people who had converted to being Jews. And they were destroying the real Israelites. So Christ said, those that say they are Jews are not. They are the synagogue of Satan.
So those people who are using the very same Bible you're using right now, what are they doing that is wrong?
What are they doing? Everything. Not only have they stolen our land, they've stolen our culture, they've stolen our identity, and taught us lies and given us crumbs in the world. Okay? Foreign aid is a crumb. That's what they've done. You got something?
No, go ahead.
Watch this. Get Galatians chapter 1, verse 6 and 7. I got to preface back to the New Testament for your listeners, because I know they're New Testament based. So I'm just going to hit them there. Watch this.
Galatians chapter
1, verse 6. Start there.
Galatians chapter 1, verse 6. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that has called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel.
Our people have been removed into another gospel. When we were enslaved and colonialized, we were removed into another gospel, a false gospel. Go ahead.
But though we, or an angel from heaven, preach another gospel unto you, than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed.
So, it's Paul says, whoever preaches a different gospel, let him be accursed. So we've been taught a white man named Jesus Christ died for our sins, and that we are Africans. But when you read the Bible, Christ is a black man who died for the children of Israel. So we have gone into another gospel. The white man has established a false gospel. The Bible says, let him be what?
Accursed.
Bible says, let him be accursed. We can't change it. We can't manipulate it. It says what it says.
Mm-hmm. Do you mind if I say something?
Okay.
Try to wrap your mind around the concept. You seem like an educated man. The people that enslaved us, and we say the white man, it's not just the white man. It's all nations have enslaved God's children. But we speak particularly about the white man because he rules the earth. But the people that enslaved all people here on St.Maarten, these are the same people that's going to teach you about righteousness and lead you to God? No, they cannot. You would not trust somebody that have enslaved you to now be the mouthpiece of God. They've used the Bible for many years throughout slavery. We were not allowed to read. Why? Because they didn't want us to understand this. And then they began to teach us about the Bible without us able to read. It's called religion. And now today when we read this, it seems shocking to people. And maybe because of the tone in which you speak, but like the bishop would say, it's passion. But one thing we can't, what people, they cannot refute, is that we're reading out the same book in which the churches have. Revelation is in everybody's book. So you can't deny Christ is black. Now to deny it, and say that he's not black and you don't believe it, you're lying to yourself. Or any man is lying to himself, and they're crazy. We just read the words of God. This is inspired of God. So we can't now negate it and say, I don't accept that, I accept this.
Okay. What are some of the criticisms you face when you come across this strong with your ideology?
The criticism is pretty much like, what does color matter? It doesn't matter. Once they find out, it's our people. Once they find out that Christ looks like them, because they have such low self-esteem and self-hate, it doesn't matter now. Mm. But it mattered when he was Caucasian, with no biblical reference. Mm, right. Now that we show a biblical reference, he's not, oh, it doesn't matter. This is brainwashing, total brainwashing. And the criticism is also, oh, you're a black separatist group. No, because the Iraq Indians are part of the 12 tribes of Israel. This is not about black and white, because like Bishop Kanai said, the Arabs had a part in our slavery. The Chinese had a part. And this is why they will never give us reparations. Reparations mean Holland must give us reparations. America, the UK, mm-hmm. Germany, France, they have to restore everything they have taken from us. And they will never do it. Never.
Mm. All right. Folks, you're listening to Viewpoint. On your viewers, on Viewpoint, of course. I'm here with both Bishop Nathaniel and Bishop Kanai. And I'm almost sure that they will be happy to take any questions from those of you who might want to ask one, and I know I don't underestimate some intelligent questions can really come from an audience. So we'll take a break, and on the other side, we'll be back in 2 and 2, but on the other side, we'll give you an opportunity to toss some questions at both Bishop Kanai and Bishop Nathaniel. We'll take a break and come back.
not everyone is going to receive of his forgiveness and grace. But I think he would extend that mercy towards anybody of color. Anyway, that's my feeling.
You said of color. I'm glad you used that term.
Well, black or white. Not white. I respect what you're saying, guys. But it doesn't change too much how I feel about it. I think God is a loving God. Mm-hmm. He's merciful. He is a God of vengeance as well. I mean, there is...
Remember, he kills everybody on
fire and wrath. That is also enveloped in that God of mercy. Mm.
You know, it's only in this time period that we've come to the point where where people believe that the kingdom is for everybody. And that was never the case.
No, I don't think the kingdom is for
everybody. No, I mean all nations. It was always, the prophets always knew that the kingdom was for the Israelites. It's this time period, because we've been misinformed, miseducated, lied to, that everybody looks at this book and think it's all-inclusive. And that's it. The Bible was written by the Israelites for the Israelites.
So the Bible is not all-inclusive.
No, it's not. St. John 3:16, we'll touch upon that too today.
We only have a half hour yet.
Okay.
But I'm enjoying this.
But we hope it provokes people to dialogue and start reading their Bible.
The preparation of our people for the coming of the Black Messiah. And of course, they are underscoring their fundamental truths that they are drawing from the Bible to support or to substantiate the claim that Christ is really a black man and the true people of Israel are black people. They're hoping as well that this discussion today will maybe start triggering the minds of people to start reading their Bible. That's what you said, Bishop, can I?
Yes, sir.
In the hope that they will start reading the Bible.
Stop singing in church all day, open the Bible, and start reading and applying what it says.
All right. Okay, we will take a couple of calls, and there we go. I'm told that there's a call online, so let's get that in quickly. Good afternoon, caller. Your own viewpoint. Go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Yes, sir.
There you go. All praises to the Most High.
Yeah. All praises.
Well, there you go. Someone.
Can I read a scripture?
Yes, go ahead.
Look at Revelation 21 and 12. About this, people think, oh, he's all inclusive, like we discussed. People, oh, it's for everybody, the kingdom's for everybody. Watch this.
The book of Revelations, chapter 21, verse 12. And had a wall, great and high, and 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and the names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel.
So on the gates of the kingdom of heaven, you have the names of the Israelites. There's no name for Chinaman. There's no name for East Indian man, Arab. It's the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. Even our people, you cannot walk up to the gate where you've got an angel there, a big black angel, and say, the angel said, who are you? Are you Judah? Are you Benjamin? You go, no, I'm St.Maarten, the Catholic. Get out of here. That's not on the gate. You have to restore and come back to who you are. That's what the Bible is saying. Oh, you know what? Another thing you said about the inclusiveness, Obadiah 18. I made a statement. Don't go to that just yet.
Okay. Let's take a call because our callers become important here.
Yes.
Since they are with us. And good afternoon, caller, you're on. Yes, sir.
The poor
Ah, thank you so much.
So now watch this. Obadiah verse 18. Watch this. This is about the kingdom of heaven. Watch.
The book of Obadiah, verse 18. And the house of Jacob shall be a fire, and the house of Joseph a flame, and the house of Esau for stubble. And they shall kindle in them and devour them, and there shall not be any remaining of the house of Esau, for the Lord hath spoken.
So the prophecy is that Esau, the whole line will be destroyed, thus saith the Lord. So now for us to read that and go, no, not my God, not my Jesus. We are rejecting the Almighty. He says he's going to do away with Esau. When you think about it, think of all the problems in the world, whether it's poverty, criminality, whatever it is. Think about who is the orchestrator of it, okay? For example, you say, oh, well, people steal because they're wicked. Okay, poverty forces people to steal, right, many times. Mm-hmm. Who established the poverty? Because St.Maarten is a rich land. You have much resources here. There should not be one impoverished person here in St.Maarten, just like in Jamaica. But what does the white man do? He rips the resources from and sends it to his lands, sends it to America, the United Kingdom, to Holland. And the people suffer poverty. What do? They rely on whether selling drugs, robbing people who have. This is the result of what this man has established throughout the earth, and it's everywhere, especially in America.
Okay, so you're helping black people to know who they are.
Yes.
What about those black people who are committing crime or doing wrong things? They might be doing it because they're motivated by maybe poverty or what have you. But yes. Is there any forgiveness?
Of
what
course.
Do you preach to those people?
Yes. Christ said we must be born again. Can we get Matthew 19 and 16? Christ had a message for our people. Because when Moses went on the mountain, he did not give Moses and the Israelites Pentecostal, Seventh-day Adventist, Jehovah Witness. He never gave that. He gave commandments. And there's about 600 laws he gave us. And the reason we went into slavery is because we broke them. So when Christ came, watch what he says.
Matthew 19, verse 16. And behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? And he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments.
Hear what Christ said? If you will enter into life, keep the commandments. None of these churches teach that. They say, oh, you have to be Seventh Day. Oh, you have to be Jehovah Witness. That's not what Messiah said. He said, keep the commandments. Our people have never been taught the commandments. Okay?
Yeah.
And the few commandments, I'll give you one basic, Leviticus 21:5. Watch this commandment, and it pertains to you. I'm looking at you. Mm-hmm. So I want you to interpret.
Leviticus chapter 21, and we're going to begin at the verse 5. And it says, thou shalt not make baldness upon thy head, neither shall thou shave off thy beard. I'm sorry, let me read that again. Thou shalt not make baldness upon thy head, neither shalt thou shave off the corner of thy beard, nor make any cuttings in their flesh.
Now that is so easy, Mr. Moore, right? That's it. It's a law.
So what does that say for me? I'm bald.
Right, right. Okay, if your head naturally falls out, fine. Mm-hmm. But now, the facial hair, mm-hmm. you can grow that. It's an easy law, right? Mm-hmm. See, but we go, oh, I want to look pretty. I want to be handsome man. That's what we do.
So would I be rejected because I'm bald?
Well, you would be rejected, like the scriptures say, rebellion mm-hmm. is as the sin of witchcraft. Mm-hmm. So if I read a law, like thou shalt not commit adultery, or thou shalt not steal, and I go, I'm not obeying that. I'm going to go against it. Then we will be rejected. Mm-hmm. Okay, once we hear and disobey purposely, that's when judgment comes on us.
Okay. So basically what you're saying there just now that we have to grow out here.
Yes, we have to grow out here.
And not
as men. Right.
And when you do that, you're
on the road. You're starting to clean your life up according to God's laws. There's, like I said, there's many laws. Like, if you're, I don't know what words you have in St. Maarten, but a homosexual, you have that word here? Use that? Sodomite, whatever.
That is used everywhere.
Okay. The Bible teaches us not to do that. So if a man reads it and goes, I reject that, he's going to be judged. He or she will be judged. You got something?
No, wait a few.
Now, Deuteronomy 22:5. Watch this law for women. Because all in St. Maarten, I see backsides everywhere, just like in America. Watch this.
The book of Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 5. The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment. For all that do so are an abomination unto the Lord thy God.
So that's another. It's an easy law. It's telling men don't dress like women, telling women don't dress like men. But America, watch what it does. America has a system where now if you look at the rappers and the gospel artists, they're forcing, like Kirk Franklin, Puffy, Sean P. Diddy, what's the other rapper's name?
Jay-Z.
Oh, many of them wearing skirts. They're trying to change the dress code of
wearing
young men.
Wearing skirts.
Yes. It's becoming a fashion trend. They already got the black woman already from the time of the 60s. They got her in trousers. Prior to that, black women never wore pants. But now it's customary to show your butts, your buttocks. I'm looking at a picture right now, right in front of me. I see the backside of a woman. That's all you see. And it what does it do? It elicits what in men? When I see a woman's butt, what do you think I'm thinking? What do you think?
No, you have to tell me what you think.
I'm going to tell you what we all think as men. Wow, look at that. And women know that. They're not stupid because when they put on the pants, they're looking at their shape. They know exactly why they're doing it. And the white man has been very clever and manipulative, knowing that they're very easy to manipulate.
So how can we save black people who are all going to fall under some of this curse that they're not doing what they're supposed to be doing? How can we save them?
The way to save, we must repent of our sins. That means, number one, come out of these false churches that your slave masters set up for you. Come out and come
all
together.
All the churches we have around you are slave
They're
churches.
All slave churches.
So
all
the only
of them.
Two churches, the church, which is Israel United.
The nation of Israel. Well, now, that's just a name.
Okay.
That's just a name.
Okay.
The Bible talks about the nation of Israel. That's who we are. Judah, Benjamin, Levi, Ephraim, Manasseh, Gad, Reuben. That's a race, a nation. We must come back to that in Christ as our king. Mm-hmm. He is our king, and we must keep the commandments.
Where did you, who helped you when you studied the Bible?
We had seven elders over us who taught us from back in the early 90s. Because I was going into Islam, trying to find my way, because Christianity, everywhere I looked, I saw white Jesus, white God, white angels, okay? And you know, there's no white angels in the Bible. Did you know that? There's no such thing as a white angel. Give me that, Ezekiel 1:13. I got to prove what I say.
But isn't it true that anything that is white is often referred to as being pure?
Yes, but the white man that we call white, he told us to call him white. Is he really white? Look at his skin. Think about a white shirt in contrast to his skin. He's red. The blood shows through his flesh. He's really red. The Bible calls Esau, the nation of Edom, the red people. That's why in the South we call them rednecks, because they're red people. The blood shows all through them. Watch this.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 1, verse 13.
About an angel. It's an angel.
For it says, as for the likeness of a living creature, their appearance was like burning coals of fire.
You know what a coal looks like, yeah. Mr. Moore? Mm-hmm. A coal is jet black. So the angel was like burning coals of fire. But then they show on TV, they got the white boy with yellow hair. And I'm so cute. No, you're the devil. That's not an angel of God. The angels are jet black. But that's such an abomination.
Why are we having so much controversial issues and things about the Bible and God?
Oh, I got to answer for you. Get that in Deuteronomy. I believe it's 33:29. Watch this. You're going to be shocked when you hear this one. If I got the right scripture, bear with me. Yeah. 33:29.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 33, verse 29. Happy art thou, O Israel, who is like unto thee, O people saved by the Lord, the shield of thy help, and who is the, it says, and who is the sword of thy excellency?
Here it comes.
And thine enemies shall be found liars unto thee, and thou shalt tread upon their high places.
You see that? Your enemies shall be found liars unto you. Our enemies have taught us everything about the Bible. They gave us our education. They have lied about everything. Everything they have lied about, Mr. Moore. So that's why there's so much controversy. Many people say, how do you get all these religions in this one Bible? Because our enemies established all these false religions. He did that. He and she. I'll say he and she.
That's something that we struggle with on a daily basis. Why so many religions?
Right. And none can be substantiated in the Bible. None of them.
Mm.
So that's the problem.
Let's take another call for you. Let's go to the phones. Good afternoon, caller. Your viewpoint.
Mr. Moore, I don't want to be on air.
But you don't want to. Just say what you have to say. That's the problem. All right. We'll talk to you later. All right. All right. All right. I think this can be unsettling for some people. How would you respond to people who think that this is somewhat unsettling?
What do you think about that question?
Yeah.
We want it to be unsettling. We want to provoke those people to start thinking. We understand that what we're saying is out of the norm of what's being taught. But this is our job. The prophets always prophesied against kingdoms, against rulership. That's a job. Churches today, they want to be accepted by the masses. We're not looking to be accepted. Well, the only one we want to be accepted by is God and Jesus Christ. And in that, our job is to raise up the children of Israel. So I want to go back real quick, because one of the things I want to touch upon is many church folk, will believe all nations could be saved. St. John 3:16, for God so loved the world. Yes. These are controversial topics. What does it mean when he says, for God so loved the world? Earlier we spoke, and it seems like it's inclusive of all nations. So I'm going to say something, and I hope it's thought-provoking. The Bible's written by the Israelites, for the Israelites, to the Israelites, Old and New Testament. And we're going to read out of the New Testament and explain it.
So, which one, John 3:16?
Yes, sir.
John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
That seems straightforward.
Yeah.
God loved the world we're in, that whoever in the world believes in him, it doesn't mean that. Now, how do I know that it doesn't mean that? Go to Psalms 111, verse 10. Remember, everything I'm going to say is going to come out the Bible. It's not going to be my words and my explanation. God will explain what he means himself.
Psalms 111, verse 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
So you want wisdom to understand what God is saying? You must fear him. These churches, they take the money. They take the tithing money. Tithes was never money. It was the first of your crops, your fruits. Every man is supposed to work and pay his own way.
So you guys don't go after money?
No. People give offerings so we can take care of the building, but we all have jobs. The church doesn't take care of me. I take care of myself, my family. That was the example of Christ. Christ was the high priest, and he was a carpenter. He had a job.
Yeah.
The church would take rob the people. So let's read it again.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do his commandments.
So if you want a good understanding, you must do his commandments. These pastors do not do the commandments. They celebrate Christmas, Easter. Half of them are homosexual. The other half are adulterers, whatever the case may be. And I'm being general. All of them may not be doing all that, but all of them are not teaching who the children of Israel are. So let's go back to St. John 3:16.
For God so loved the world.
What world? Isaiah 45:17. We're going to see the world that God loved. It said God loved the world. Now, God would know which world he's talking about, right? Let's see.
Isaiah chapter 45 and verse 17.
The Bible will explain itself. It's not hard. It's very easy if you're doing his commandments.
Here we go. But Israel shall be saved in the Lord.
What is it? To be saved, there must be a savior, right? Israel may be saved in the Lord.
But Israel shall be saved in the Lord with an everlasting salvation. Ye shall not be ashamed nor confounded, world without end.
That's the world God was talking about, the world of Israel.
All right, hold it there for a second. Let me include a phone call. Good afternoon, caller. You're on.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Yes, I'm fine.
I would like to ask the judge one. If he knows that white man were not given the right to by he himself to me, is not given the good message, because God discriminates against
All right. Thank you so much for that. How do you respond?
Now that's everything that the lady said was unscriptural. She said God does not discriminate. We read it over and over, but we read it again. God does not discriminate. Discriminate to choose one over another, right? That's the definition. Let's go to Book of Romans chapter 9. Mind you, everybody, everything we're saying, we're going to read a scripture for. We're not going to give you opinion. Romans chapter 9, verse 10.
Romans 9, verse 10. And not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac, for the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil.
So the children are not born yet. Neither have either one of the children done good or evil.
That the purpose of God, according to election, might stand. Not of works, but of him that calleth.
So God is going to choose somebody. Not of works, but who he elects to choose. Read on.
It was said unto her, the elder shall serve the younger.
So wait a second. Before they were born, God discriminated. He said the elder is going to be a servant to the younger. Read on.
As it is written, Jacob have I loved. But Esau have I hated.
And that's okay. Before they were born.
All right, let's go to the telephone and take another call. Good afternoon, caller. You have your point. Go ahead. I'm fine, thanks. All right. Thank you for your call. Appreciate your comment. I think that's the final call we'll take because we're just about time to wrap it up. But do you have it? You heard what?
Yes, we appreciate your unscriptural belief, your Bible, unscriptural Bible belief. The Bible says in Isaiah 34, verse 8, for it is the day of the Lord's vengeance and the year of recompense for the controversy of Zion. This is controversy. Well, the Bible is controversial. So for people to say, it's not thought-provoking. Yes, it is. Because the whole word of God is a thought-provoking, controversial word, as we just read.
Mm-hmm. So it's not left up to one's individual belief?
Exactly. Not at all.
It's only what the Bible says.
God says, thou shalt not...
What about the interpretation of what's in the Bible? Do people have a problem with that?
Many people have a problem with it, but the interpretations are easy. For example, your sons and daughters shall be given to another people. They will have yokes of iron on their neck.
What does that mean?
Slavery. It's not hard, but people make it hard because they reject the truth. Mm-hmm. That's what it means. It's so simple.
Yeah. I would like to say to all people that there is nothing wrong with listening to what anyone has to say. If you're uncomfortable with it, I mean, maybe you need to figure out what is uncomfortable about it. But I do know that from the moment I knew that I was having you on the program today, that there might be some controversy coming out here. Shall people be afraid of this?
No.
What is in it for them?
What's in it for them?
And what are you doing when you provoke people's thinking along this line? How do you get them to align themselves with what is right?
Well, what we'd like them to do is visit our website at www.israelunite.org for more information. Mm-hmm. Our people must gather together. Destruction is coming. The Bible talks about World War III. It is coming. You see, the Trump administration, he's not going to be the last president. There's going to be another that's going to do worse. It's going to get worse. Destruction is coming. Our people playing games in these little slave religions they're in, come out, repent as you go, and get yourself right. Mm-hmm. Matthew 11, verse 6, Christ said,
when you do that, how do you get nurtured along and helped along?
By keeping God's laws. And we're here to help. We are here to help. That's why the contact I gave your callers, your listeners, they can reach us. We will help. Our job is to help instruct the people, build the men up to become leaders.
Would you consider yourself prophets?
Yes.
Modern-day prophets?
Modern-day prophets, yes. Teachers of the Lord. Hey. So the men, Mr. Moore, the men must be built up here in St. Maarten. That's why you see these little young boys running wild around here, because the older men are afraid of them, unable to organize them, because there's nothing here for them. So the men must get a backbone out there and come together and organize these young boys so they can deal right with the women. You understand that? It's an easy thing.
We don't have enough time to get deep into this, but I like your spirit.
We hope you invite us back again. Don't be afraid.
In due time.
Okay.
Your why sponsors, Michael, I don't know about that.
Excuse me?
Your sponsors might be upset.
Oh. Well, folks, I'm flabbergasted. All right. I want to thank you for being there in the audience and having listened to the program throughout. For those of you who find it unsettling, again, I mean, you have the Word of God for yourself. I think every home have a Bible. Read it for yourself and make sure that what you're convicted of as being true, that's what you hold on to, because it's your God speaking to you. Bishop Nathaniel, Bishop Kanai, thank you both.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I appreciate it.
And listen, you already dust off your Bible and actually read it.
Alrighty. Okay, then that's it for today. We invite you to come back and join us again tomorrow. We will have an interesting show for you. Until then, enjoy the rest of your Wednesday. The news is next.
Shalom, Israel. I'm Elder Nathaniel of Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC to stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this and join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.